Welcome to another episode about the geomorphology of the Carolina Bays. In this presentation, I will try to determine the geologic mechanism that produced the peculiar bell-shaped geometry of some Carolina Bays near New Egypt, New Jersey. The glacier ice impact hypothesis proposes that the Carolina Bays were formed from oblique secondary impacts of glacier ice chunks ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet. The ice impacts produced inclined conical cavities that became shallow elliptical basins by viscous relaxation. However, the shapes of the Carolina Bays depend on the characteristics of the terrain on which they are made. The bell-shaped Carolina Bay illustrated in this LiDAR image is located 2 miles east of New Egypt, New Jersey. The colorized topography indicates that the terrain is uneven and the distorted bay is adjacent to some hills. There are no pyramids in New Egypt. Apparently, the only pyramid in New Jersey is a tomb of C.F. Harms in the Flower Hill Cemetery of North Bergen, New Jersey, about 57 miles away. New Egypt is a small community in New Jersey. It was originally given the name Egypt in 1793, and it was changed to New Egypt in 1801. A reference in Wikipedia says that the name is believed to be a biblical allusion about going to Egypt for corn that was plentiful in the area. In chapter 42 of Genesis, Jacob said, "Behold, I have heard that there is corn in Egypt." I often come across curious and unexpected local stories while doing research on the Carolina Bays. New Jersey has many Carolina Bays, but they are generally small. They measure from 150 to 200 meters in diameter, and they give the appearance of a landscape pelted by a shotgun blast. These features have been the subject of much speculation, but similar surface patterns can be produced by impacts of ice projectiles using an experimental model. An article published in the Journal of Geology on March of 1953 by Peter Wolf described the features as periglacial frost thaw basins in New Jersey. The abstract says, "Basins with interior drainage are of widespread occurrence on the New Jersey coastal plain. They are oval, irregular, shallow depressions without rims or orientation and occur on all lithologic formations. The presence of extensive frost wedge fillings, involutions, festoons, and other frost structures indicate that the area was exposed to a colder climate than that of today. The origin of the basins is attributed to frost thaw action and subsidence in the periglacial zone when the continental ice sheet stood just north of the coastal plain in Pleistocene time and is likened to the subsidence thaw basins being formed in Arctic regions today." In essence, Peter Wolf considered the basins in New Jersey to be just like the thermokarst lakes found in Alaska that originate from sinkholes when the subsurface ice melts. 6 months later, W.C. Rasmussen wrote a rebuttal to Wolf in a paper titled "The Periglacial Frost Thaw Basins in New Jersey, a Discussion." The paper says, "Wolf has made a contribution to the problem of basins of interior drainage on the Atlantic coastal plain." Notice the discordant wording of the first sentence, which sets the tone of the paper. Rasmussen says that Wolf has made a contribution to the problem, rather than a contribution to the solution of the problem, and he continues. "His observation of involutions, festoons, and filled wedges in the upper 3 to 10 feet of sediment of several of these basins is inductive evidence of periglacial action. That it may be thereby deduced that the basins were created by periglacial action is a step beyond the evidence presented." Wow! My English teacher would have given me a bad grade for that sentence. A better way to say it is that the evidence presented is not sufficient to deduce that the basins were created by periglacial action. Rasmussen continues, "An additional fact, which has not yet appeared in the literature, but which will perforce have to be considered by all geologists who work on this problem of basins of interior drainage in the Atlantic coastal plain, is that such basins are scattered over the whole stretch from the type base of the Carolinas to the basins of New Jersey. Prouty in 1952 mapped the bays from northern Florida through Georgia, South Carolina, and North Carolina." Rasmussen then says, "If periglacial phenomena should be the major contributing cause, then one would have to argue periglacial conditions for about 850 miles from New Jersey to Florida." Even today, many geologists dismiss the impact origin of the Carolina Bays and attribute their origin to freeze and thaw cycles or to wind and water mechanisms. To understand how the bell-shaped bay formed, we need to pay attention to the landscape. This image highlights a range of hills that splits into a fork. New Egypt and the bell-shaped basin are in the valley between the branches of the fork. These hills are not high. Their elevations do not exceed 100 meters above sea level. It is important to note that the bell-shaped bay is along the slope of the elevated terrain highlighted in this image. We can explore the possibility that the conical impact that made the basin was distorted by the downhill flow of liquefied soil at the time of emplacement. As we zoom in on the terrain, we see more details of the valley between the ranges of hills. We can see that the bell-shaped bay is surrounded by natural fluvial channels originating in the hills and draining toward the southwest. The landscape also has many straight lines that demarcate agricultural plots around the bay. The colorized topography shows very clearly the fluvial channels on both sides of the bay. Only 5 points are needed to specify the path of an ellipse, so it is possible to fit ellipses to Carolina Bays even when they are partially obscured or they have been modified by terrain movement, like in this case. Using the least squares method, we can fit an ellipse to the points along the perimeter that is not distorted and determine that the azimuth of the bell-shaped bay is 124 degrees. Extending the azimuth toward the Great Lakes, we find that a great circle trajectory meets Saginaw Bay and Lake Huron at a distance of 846 kilometers. Saginaw Bay has been proposed as the location of an extraterrestrial impact. I usually use the terrain option in Google Earth to determine the elevation of geological features based on the position of the cursor. For this image, the elevation of the rim on the east side was 37.1 meters above sea level. However, when I placed a cursor in the center of the bay, Google Earth indicated that the elevation was 55 meters above sea level. This could not be right. The rims of Carolina Bay should always be higher than the center of the bay. From the satellite image, I noticed that the bay was a thickly wooded area. I sent an email about the discrepancy between the elevation of the rim and the center of the bay to Michael Davias, who provides the LiDAR visualization tool for Google Earth. Michael replied that the USGS Elevation Point Query Service is more reliable. Entering the coordinates, I found that the elevation of the center of the bay is 35.5 meters above sea level and the rim is at 37.1 meters above sea level. Perhaps the elevation provided by Google Earth was for the top of the trees that are on the bay. Using the elevations provided by the U.S. Geological Survey, the rim of the bay is 1.6 meters higher than the center, which is in the expected range for Carolina Bays. This image illustrates the material flow after a penetration funnel is made on uphill terrain. The force of gravity on ground liquefied by the seismic vibrations of the impact causes the whole terrain to slide downhill, and the overhang on the leading edge of the conical cavity collapses into the cavity, thereby distorting the elliptical shape of the conic section. This animation shows the formation of a conical cavity by the impact of an ice projectile on terrain inclined toward the direction from which the impact is coming. As the ice projectile melts, hydrostatic pressure reduces the depth of the cavity. Also, the overhang of the leading edge collapses and modifies the shape of the bay. Viscous relaxation reduces the conical cavity to a shallow depression with raised rims, and the leading edge of the cavity is distorted by the collapse of the overhanging flange. This mechanism can be demonstrated with a physical model. The left image shows that the deep penetration of an ice projectile on a viscous medium creates an overhanging flange. The flange collapses during viscous relaxation and produces a bell-shaped basin similar to the one near New Egypt. It is curious that the bell-shaped bay looks like a pedestal surrounded by low terrain, but this may be explained by the erosion caused by the fluvial channels on both sides of the bay. Approximately 1 meter of the terrain surrounding the bay has been eroded. The action of wind and water over thousands of years has created beautiful and enigmatic features in the landscape. The amazing geological structures of the Carolina Bays are not less remarkable than those found in national parks. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. There's a link to the LiDAR visualization tool in the description of the video. I will continue to examine the mechanisms that made the Carolina Bays based on the principles of experimental physics. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays and other scientific topics.